with a backdrop of the mountains of the Eiffel, Charles Martel stood outside of Cologne. This Merovingian king of the Franks had defeated the Moors down in the south, and now, just like his ancestor Pepin, he was ready to take a stand in the north to conquer this area from the pagan heathens. Who would dare to stand in his way? Why, enter Radbod, king of the Frisians. A badass for sure in his own right. However, he had been defeated before by Pippin of Heristal in the Battle of Dorestad, where he was supposed to secede West Frisia, meaning near Frisia, from the Scheldt till the Vlie to the Franks. So, defeating him did not seem impossible to Charlemagne. However, Pippin died in 714, causing Charles Martel to take his place. Would he be able to stand up to the task? Radbod was now in his home territory, Friesland. But who really is Radbod? He is actually referred to as Duke in Latin, Dux, and previously to coming to Friesland, he was in Denmark, amassing a massive army to face off against Charles Martel. And before we return to the battle, we must first mention the Vita Wulframni, the false baptism, one of his most famous stories, which is where he, very skeptically, is about to be baptized by Bishop Wulfram, a man who had married his daughter off to another Christian man, and so he had his trust. But then Radbod inquires about a small detail, his ancestors. What happens to those who died without knowing the Lord? Are they in heaven or hell? Bishop Wulfram, with some apprehension, informs Radbod that they are definitely in hell. Radbod withdraws his one foot from the front, therefore not completing the rite, not wanting to be in afterlife without the companionship of his forefathers, crying out that he would rather be spending eternity in hell than be in the heavens with his enemies, thus being the Franks. Now that truly paints a good picture of who Charles Martel is. Later on, he even ran those monks, Bishop Wulfram, and the other ministries out of his land, thus returning the religion back to paganism, and so on. Now, I am not much of a pagan myself, nor very sympathetic towards them. However, when we read the accounts of Willibrord's and the other Carolingian-sponsored missions into Frisia, one can't help but root for the pagans in this instance. Much of these missions are not so much focused on spreading the word of the Lord, but much rather in spreading the rule of the Carolingian dynasty. And so it was Dux Radbod, or Rex Radbod, who was able to make the Franks retreat all the way to Cologne, where he was able to face off against this man. Sure, he had some defeats under his belt, and he also had some victories, some very impressive ones. But this would surely be the greatest struggle he would ever have. And so there Charles Martel stood, facing off against King Radbod, allied with the Neustrians and many others. To Martel, it must have looked like waves upon waves of heretics. And they just kept coming. One wave after another kept besieging them, attacking them from each side, until finally they lost. And finally, Charles Martel had to retreat towards the mountains of the Eiffel. And after a short siege with a certain king and the Neustrians, Cologne fell. Now something interesting should be mentioned about the battles of the Frisian-Frankish Wars. Dorestad is greatly detailed in how the attack happened. Same with Amblevier, in which a feigned retreat was used, one of the famous Mongol Three Favorite tactics, and how it was one of Charles Martel's major victories in his life. The Boran, where the Frisians attempted the amphibious attack. However, Cologne, the only battle left of these four battles, has no details about it. It should be mentioned that all of this is chronicled by the Franks. Very interesting. Ignoring the possible bias of the victors, natural as that may be, history threaded on, and the Battle of Amblivier took place near Amel in 716. There, the success of Radbot would come to a halt, where he, in a long battle, would face defeat to Charles Montel. Of course, this battle was won through one of the Franks' famous battle tactics, retreating. They faked their retreat and fell back to a defensive line where they were able to defeat them. However, the Frisians were still able to inflict immense amounts of casualties. But the battle was still won, and Charles Montel now was able to force Radbot to retreat once more, and even got his loyalty later on. But did he? Around the end of King Radbot's, or now Duke Radbot's life, he was amassing an army once again, getting ready for yet another fight. But before this army could be realized, he died. But what should be mentioned about this absolute legend of a man is that he was able to still strike fear in the hearts of all of the Frankish kingdoms. This tiny territory, this single man, was able to strike fear in the hearts of all Franks. He, among various other interesting figures of Dutch history, was able to later on shape the identity that would become the Dutch peoples.